Hello everyone, you're watching Physio Classroom channel, and in today's video we are going to discuss the neurophysiology of sparsity development. Now, sparsity can be defined as an abnormal increase in muscle tone which is characterized by a hyperactive muscle stretch reflex and which is velocity dependent in nature. Now, as we all know that sparsity is seen in upper motor neuron lesions, but at the same time it is also interesting to note that all upper motor neuron lesions does not lead to spasticity. Yes, upper motor neuron lesions can also be further classified into three main types. Like for example, the extrapyramidal disorders, the Parkinson's disease is also a UMN condition, but in such a case we do not see spasticity. Instead, we see rigidity to be manifesting in the patient. Similarly, in cerebellar disorders and pure cortical strokes, we see that patient is having relatively hypotonia. So we will be decoding all these three variety of upper motor neuron lesions in this and upcoming video. So now let's quickly understand the neurophysiology of sparsity development, and by understanding the neurophysiology, it will become very clear why there is hyperactive stretch reflex in sparsity, and most importantly, why sparsity is considered to be velocity dependent. So now, from our previous two videos, we already have a very good understanding about the functioning of the muscle stretch reflex as well as the neurophysiological mechanism behind the maintenance of the normal tone. So now, as we already described before, that sparsity will occur only when the pyramidal and the extrapyramidal systems are not going to function properly, as these are the structures and pathways where there will be lesion. So now let's have a look what is going to happen with the muscle stretch reflex, which is going to make it hyperactive. Now we know this, that the cortex is responsible for the production of voluntary movements and it is facilitatory in nature, whereas the extrapyramidal system is responsible for the regulation or modulation of the motor movements. So now, in a normal individual, the excitatory discharges from the reticular activating system to the gamma motor neuron are controlled by the higher centers, namely the pyramidal and the extrapyramidal systems, the cortex facilitating the discharges, and the basal ganglia regulating or inhibiting the discharges of the reticular activating system. Now, because now both the systems are not functioning properly, so now the reticular activating system is on its own and it has no superior to it. In such a situation, the excitatory discharges to the gamma motor neuron are going to be uncontrolled, and these excitatory discharges will depend upon the number or intensity of the sensory input that the patient is going to perceive. Like for example, we see that when a stroke patient is resting, he is lying or he is sitting, relatively the sparsity will be less. But the moment the stroke patient tries to stand and walk, or he puts some extra effort, immediately he becomes more stiff or spastic. Now, as we know that majority of the sensations that are perceived by the brain are passing through the brainstem region, and reticular activating system is basically a group of nuclei which is present in and around the brainstem. And so the reticular activating system always remains aware of almost each and every sensory input that the brain perceives. And depending on those sensory inputs, the reticular activating system decides the intensity of the discharges that it has to send to the gamma motor neuron. Very basic example by which we can understand this mechanism of the reticular activating system firing the gamma motor neuron is what happens when someone, maybe your friend, suddenly frightens you. You immediately have a change in your posture, your gesture and emotions. Now, how is all this happening? This all is happening involuntarily by the brainstem pathways that are coming from the pontine and the medullary region of the brainstem and descending down to the spinal cord. So now let's understand what is going to happen to the muscle stretch reflex if the descending excitatory discharges from the reticular activating system to the gamma motor neurons are going to be uncontrolled. In such a situation, there is going to be excessive firing of the gamma motor neuron, and as a result, the intrafusal fibers tension is going to get increased. Now this increase in tension is going to be perceived by the 1A fiber, and 1A fibers are going to in turn stimulate the alpha motor neuron, and so the alpha motor neuron discharges to the extrafusal fiber is going to increase, and as a result the person is going to have more tone in the muscle. So let me make it more clear and simplified, especially for the BPT students. Now if we are moving a spastic joint more vigorously, what it is going to do is it is also going to stimulate lot of proprioceptors in the joint, and these proprioceptors are going to travel through the dorsal column into the brainstem, and this sensation is also going to be perceived by the reticular activating system. In response to this afferent increase in the input, the reticular discharges to the gamma motor neuron are also going to increase, and as a result the intrafusal fibrotension is also going to be much more, and there will be increased conduction through the muscle stretch reflex, and at the end the spastic muscle offering more resistance to the movement. So now I hope I am making it clear for you. Excessive gamma discharges leading to excessive firing of the intrafusal fibers, leading to excessive firing of the 1A fiber, and at the end the alpha motor neuron firing to the extrafusal fiber of the spastic muscle getting increased, more contraction in the spastic muscle. Therefore, I always advise the junior physios and the students to never encourage fast passive movements. I see lot of relatives of the stroke patients and spinal cord injury patients thinking that more they do the movement, more the stroke patient is going to become better. But this is not the case. We should never encourage fast passive movements as a therapy for UMN disorder patients, as they are going to lead to more hyperactivity of the muscle stretch reflex and increase in the spasticity. Now students, also please note that I have not touched the descending motor control to the alpha motor neuron, because all remember that it is the gamma motor neuron excessive firing which is actually the mechanism of spasticity development. Poor control over the alpha motor neuron is the reason for poor voluntary control, that is patient finding it difficult to produce a movement. So I sincerely hope that I was able to simplify the mechanism of spasticity development for you all. In the next upcoming neurophysiology video, we are going to talk about the mechanism of rigidity development. Rigidity is seen in those upper motor neuron lesions in which there is only pure extrapyramidal system dysfunction and the pyramidal system is intact. So see you all in our next video. Till then, keep learning, keep sharing, and stay connected.